Hello all. Let us look into the motivation for using convolutional neural networks instead of multi-layer perceptrons in problems such as image classification. So in image classification problem, we are given a set of images and we need to classify them into a set of given classes. For example, consider a set of classes such as cat, truck and boat. If a human is shown the following image, we will immediately identify this to be a cat. On the other hand, say the same image is fed into a computer. So the computer identifies this image as a 3D array of number with integers between 0 to 255. Here 3D, because we are giving an RGB image of 3 channels, therefore each pixel will have 3 values. So the computer needs to identify these numbers belong to which of the given class. This is not an easy task because identifying a given animal or object from just numbers is difficult. So the problem that we have in hand right now is, given the input as image, we need to build a classifier that will give us the correct label. For this purpose, let us first look into the data set that we are considering in this case. We are using the CIFAR-10 data set, that is, it has 10 classes, as you can see, plane, car, bird, cat, deer, dog, frog, horse, ship, truck. These are the few training images that we have in the data set. So overall, we have 50,000 training images, 10,000 testing images, and each image is of size 32 cross 32. Let us first look into classifying these images using multilayer perceptron. So the general architecture of multilayer perceptron has an input layer and an output layer. For simplicity, let us consider a single hidden layer. In our case, we have inputs of size 32 cross 32, and since we have 3 channels, the total input size would be 32 cross 32 cross 3. And on the same lines, the number of neurons in the output layer would be 10 because we have 10 classes. So the steps in training a neural network for a multilayer perceptron is as follows. First, during forward propagation, we feed the images to the network, obtain the label from the network and compare it with the true label that we have. Using that, we get the loss function. So in the back propagation pass, we calculate the gradients with respect to the loss obtained. And then the last step is updating the parameters using the gradient. So these three steps are repeated for all the images in the training data set, and then the network is tested on the testing images. So in testing, we identify the performance or accuracy of the network in doing the task of image classification. So let us see the role of hidden neurons on the accuracy. We see that in the case of using 10 neurons, the accuracy obtained is 40.6%. Using 50 neurons, we have 48%. And as we increase it to 100 neurons, it goes to 51.8%. And by increasing the hidden neurons beyond that, we do not see any significant increase in the accuracy. This is because of overfitting of the data during training. To understand this, let us look into it further. So now let us consider the network with just 100 hidden neurons. We have seen that the size of the image is 32 cross 32 cross 3, that is 3072. Therefore, the number of parameters in just between the input layer and hidden layer would be 307,200. This is a huge number, whereas the number of training samples that we have is just 50,000. On the same line, we see that if the image size is of say 960 cross 70 cross 3, by just rastering the input as a single vector for the multilayer perceptron, we see that the size of input layer becomes huge and the number of parameters blows up to a very large value. This will definitely lead into overfitting and as well as increase the complexity of the network and therefore increase the time required for training the network. We have also seen that In spite of increasing the hidden neurons, we are not able to obtain better accuracy using multilayer perceptrons. Can we do something better? So, as studied in the class, the experiments done by Hubel and Wiesel on the visual cortex of a cat say that the features are arranged in a hierarchy of simple cells, complex cells and hypercomplex cells, which are responsible for identifying low level, mid level and high level features respectively. So, this idea has been used in neural networks for image classification and so on. So, the basic blocks in a convolutional neural network are convolution and pooling. So, during convolution, what we do is we identify features. That is, we identify a filter or a kernel that can extract features from the given input. During pooling, we bring in invariance by discarding a few values. We will understand this further. So, what happens during convolution? So, given a 32x32x3 image as seen before, let us consider a filter of size 5x5x3. So, this filter is moved all along the image starting from the topmost corner to the bottommost opposite corner. For each of the location at which the filter is placed, we take the dot product with the values correspondingly of the image and obtain a single output value. So, as the filter is moved all along the image, for each of the given filter, we would obtain an activation map of this form. That is, for a 32x32x3 image, convolving it with a 5x5x3 filter, we would obtain an activation map of size 28x28x1. This was obtained using a single filter. Suppose we had 6 such filters. We would finally obtain 28x28x6 as the output from this convolution layer. So, now this forms the new input of size 28x28x6. So, what happens in the CNN architecture is we would be stacking multiple convolution layers after one another for feature extraction. So, here we see that we have a 5x5x3 filters of 6 in number, therefore, the output obtained is 28x28x6. In the next layer, we have filters of size 5x5x6 and 10 of such filters. Therefore, the output obtained is 24x24x10 and so on. The key thing to note here is the only parameters that need to be learnt during training are these 5x5x3 filters and 5x5x6 filters. Based on the number of filters that we have here, the complexity of the network increases. But this is much less than the complexity as seen in the multilayer perceptron. The next block we have is the pooling layer. That is, for this example, let us consider max pooling. So, max pooling discards 75% of the activations in this case. So, what exactly happens here is we downsample the input by 2 along the width and height by performing pooling over a 2x2 grid with stride 2. That is, so given the activation map, we take a 2x2 grid, identify the maximum value and keep only the maximum value. We discard the remaining values that are present at that location. Similarly, we move to the next location and see that the maximum value here is 6. The next location 7 and the next location 4. So, this brings in some sort of invariance that is present in the image. For example, if you have identified a cat, maybe the cat's ear might be here in one image, but in another image, the cat's ear might be somewhere here. So, as long as you identify that a ear is present, the exact location, whether top corner or bottom, does not matter for the network. By bringing in such invariances, we are also reducing the total number of parameters that are required for training the network. The overall setup of a convolutional neural network is as follows. The input is fed to a stack of convolutional layers followed with an activation map, which are again followed with multiple convolution layers, pooling layers and so on as required for the given task. Finally, they are connected to a fully connected layer from which we obtain the labels for the given data set. So, using this, we see that we are able to reduce the number of parameters that are required for training the network in spite of increasing the number of layers during training. You are encouraged to use the CIFAR-10 data set initially to compare between the multilayer perceptron and the convolutional neural network approach to calculate the accuracy that you obtain. Once you are comfortable using both the networks, you are encouraged to use other data sets and see the performance on the accuracy obtained using them. Thank you.